got to figure out a way to get inside his head.
There's a woman in a refugee camp who claims she's his wife.
For the blood of Christ. Never gets old. A song sung about the blood never gets old. It's always good. Gets you fired up. It's been said before, if the blood misses you, heaven will miss you. They'll be without a soul if the blood doesn't hit. If you would, turn your Bibles to Philippians chapter number 1. We'll look at verse number 25 through verse number 30 tonight. We've been going through a study on the book of Philippians, and it's been of great help. Remember, Paul was in prison and writing this letter to the church at Philippi and trying to encourage them. The whole theme of the book, as we go through it, you'll hear me emphasize, is the thought of humility and how Christ portrayed that, and how we should also, the pattern that he gives and so forth, that he gives for humility. I'm going to back up. We're going to start in verse number 25 and preach on through the rest of the chapter tonight, but I want to back up just for sake of the context that we're in. Verse 21 says, "For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But if I live in the flesh, this is the fruit of my labor. Yet what I shall choose I want not. For I am in a strait between the two, having a desire to depart, to go be with Christ, which is far better. Nevertheless, to abide with you in the flesh is more needful." And Paul's speaking about how he was confident, how God would take care of him no matter where he was at, through life or through death. Paul knew that God would take care of him, God would provide for him, and whatever came in his life. We preached on last Wednesday night, I'm a winner either way. Whatever happens, we win in the end. We've read the back of the book. We have God's promises that we're standing on, as the song said earlier. We're standing on those promises. We know that God's got a better way, a higher plan for our life. He knows our path. He knows the direction that we need to go. The steps of a good man are ordered from the Lord. God provides. God, where God guides, he provides. He takes care of us. And whatever happens in our life, although it might look like a mistake, even sometimes in our eyes, and think, man, how could this work out? God will cause us to win in the end. God's doing some great things. So we are winners either way. Tonight I want to preach on the subject, a very simple subject of your need for me. Your need for me. In verse number 25, let me say this right here, that when I say your need for me, the title tonight is basically saying that you need me. You need me. And I need you. And that's what Paul deals with through the remainder of the chapter, how believers are dependent upon each other. Paul told the Philippians, brothers, you need me. The reason that he says in the previous verses, he said, I have a desire to go be with Christ, which would be so much better. I'd explore the great splendor of heaven. I would get in a new body and get transformed, as we covered in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. The body would be changed over. He would experience the presence of the Lord, to see his other believers that are saved. But he says, it's better for me now to stay here with you. You need me. And that's what God was calling him to do. Now, Paul needed the Philippians, and the Philippians needed Paul. And ever since the beginning, God has made it so that each one of us need each other. That's God's plan. Each one of us need each other. Adam needed Eve. He couldn't have made it. Now, ladies, a good time to step up, shout, jump, run the aisle. Adam could have never made it without Eve. I thought Eve got him in trouble. He needed a helpmeet. He needed somebody. There's a couple of women got in there on that one. He needed a helpmeet because he is a needy individual. Lot needed Abraham. And if Lot had stayed closer to Abraham, he wouldn't have ended up in so much trouble. But he was a needy person who needed Abraham. Moses needed Aaron and Hur. They helped him in the battle. The three Hebrew boys needed each other inside the fire. The Israelites needed David to step up that day. Although he was young and ruddy and they thought he couldn't do a whole lot, they found out in the end that they even needed a little bitty shepherd boy. Yeah. God used David in the lives of the Israelites, and they were a needy people. And you could go on and on how God has used people in people's lives, and how important it is for us to stick together. What's the scripture? I can't even think about it. But what is it? Three-chord string? Something is three-fold chord. There it is. Come on up here and preach this. I was preaching one time Yeah, no, Brother Patrick was preaching one time, and he stumbled over the verse just like that, and it was very simple. And he said, "Go ahead, Brother LaVon, finish." And I was on the front pew, and I stumbled all over the place, couldn't finish it myself. And so he just said, "We just better turn there. We just better turn there." But there's strength in numbers, and God has made it so that you and I need each other. I read this evening a cute little thing. It said, from the deck of a cruise ship, a pastor saw a small island with a bearded man shouting and desperately waving his hands. And the passenger talked to the captain and said, "Who is that?" And the captain said, "I have no idea, but every year when we pass by this island, he goes nuts." He needed some help. We are a needy people. Another one said, a man was walking down the street and saw a man struggling with a washing machine in his front door. The man ran over and said, "Let me help you." After wrestling with the washer for about 30 minutes, the helper said, "Man, I don't think we're ever going to get this washing machine out of your house." The homeowner said, "I was trying to get the washing machine into my house." Sometimes our help ain't what it should be. But we are a needy people. We need each other. We need to stick together. We need each other. Oftentimes, we as humans, we become independent. And we feel like we have everything figured out. Even sometimes people quit church, or they get out of church and say, "I don't need church no more. I'll just watch it on TV. And I'll just watch Benny Hinn or somebody on TV, and I'll be okay. I'll teach my family. I'll provide for my family the Word of God." And it might start out good, and the intention might be good, but it leads to a place where they're right back into debauchery and sin. They're right back doing the same things because of their independence. We need to be dependent upon God and His people. We need each other. I need you, and you need me. Churches need pastors. Pastors need friends. Pastors need pastors. That's why God made churches. And that's why God put pastors in churches, because churches need pastors. And pastors need the help from the Lord. We are a needy people. And that's the subject that Paul deals with here in this chapter, in Philippians chapter 1, verse number 25. And I want to give you just a few things. Look at verse number 25 and verse number 26. I want to look at Paul's believed deliverance. Paul's believed deliverance. He thought that something was going to happen. Now, we know where he was at. We know his situation. So he was saying that I'm a winner either way. If I get out of here, or if they take my life in here or right outside here, I'm a winner either way. But in verse number 25, he says, "And having this confidence, I know that I shall abide and continue with you all for furtherance, for your furtherance and joy of faith." Paul's believed deliverance. Paul believed that he was going to get out of this present situation. He didn't just give up and give in just because he was in a tight place. And we've talked about his bonds and his weights and his chains and so forth. He didn't just give up. Paul had confidence in God that God was going to bring him through. And his confidence was in verse number 24 when he said, "Nevertheless, to abide with the flesh is more needful for you." He knew that God had a bigger plan for his life, for him to die at that point. He did eventually die, but God had more for his life. And the Apostle Paul had it in his heart that God was going to use him in a special way at Philippi and other churches. And Paul believed that he would be delivered in his situation. The reason that he did, two reasons that he gives in verse number 25, is first of all for their furtherance. He says in verse number 25, the latter part, he said, "I know that I shall abide and continue with you all for your furtherance." And the word furtherance there is the word progress or advancement. And Paul said, I'm gonna come through this. I'm going to get out of here. They're not going to take my life for your furtherance. I'm going to be able to help you progress and advance in your Christian faith. And, you know, God puts different people at different times in your life to help you progress. He allows things to go on in churches that churches will get stagnant and cold and indifferent, and they'll stay just stagnant, not moving forward, like an old pond that doesn't receive any water or doesn't give any water back out. It becomes stagnant. God will allow churches to go through difficulties so He can get things moving inside the church. Even inside a Christian's heart, God allows things to happen. And God put specific people in your life at just the right time. And Paul believed that he was going to be the one to help them to grow and mature in their faith. I was talking to a pastor some time back, a pastor friend of mine. And they were going through difficulties. Another pastor I knew was going through difficulty and losing some people. And I was losing some people and saying, Lord, what is going on? And that brother really helped me out. He said, look, those people are not for the stage that your church is in right now. God's moving things out so he can do things, and he'll add back for the stage that the church is in. And every church goes through seasons. Every church goes through stages, and they just wouldn't write for the stage that the church is at this point. And I thought, man, that makes perfect sense. But God puts people in places at just the right time. And Paul expected to get out so he could further them or advance them in the faith and help them out. And God puts situations. Time won't allow us to talk about situations. And we talked about a couple Wednesday nights ago about adversity. God allows adversity in your life to progress you. He puts situations in your life to progress you. But he also puts people in your life to progress you. We'll get stagnant, we'll get cold without somebody in our life to progress us. And, you know, I'll tell you, raising kids will progress you. It'll cause you to pray. If you're not a prayer by raising kids, I'm not talking about my kids, they're wonderful kids, but we've done some praying, right? A marriage will cause you to do some praying, right? You'll get a hold of God through prayer. Some of y'all scared to say amen right there, but a couple of you did. A marriage will cause you. But you know what? God puts your spouse and your children, your co-workers in your life to progress you, just like he does situations and circumstances. He'll put somebody in your life. And the Apostle Paul was what God would use in the Philippian church to encourage them and promote them and advance them in their walk for the Lord. Sometimes churches, sometimes pastors, sometimes even members change so God can progress people in the Lord. The old saying is, you ought to bloom where you're planted. You ought to bloom around those that are around you. You find somebody difficult to work with on the job constantly, and everybody has them on every job. Don't try to change jobs. It's like changing churches. You change jobs, you just change different situation, a different place. Just change different people, the same old things are going to happen anyway. So you just got to learn to bloom where you're planted and trust that God putting something in your life. You have somebody difficult in your life to deal with every single day. It might not be that person has a lot of lack only. It might just be that God is trying to do something in your own life that you can't see. He's done it so many times on me. Why am I here? Why is this person doing that? Why is that? Because not only is God doing something in that person's life, he was doing something in mine. God puts people in our lives at different times to do different things. And then he said the second thing he believed God was going to deliver for was your joy of faith. The word joy is simply gladness in the faith. And what greater joy? Can you imagine that the Apostle Paul was saying, when I get out of here, I'm going to come to you, I'm going to help you advance you, I'm going to preach to you, I'm going to preach the word, and we're going to see you grow. And he said, when I come there, it's going to increase your faith and your joy. And Paul was confident in what God was doing. He said it two different times in this chapter. I'm confident in this very thing. And he says it again. I have confidence that God's going to deliver me. He's going to take me out of this present situation. I'm going to be able to come to you one of these days. And can you imagine what it would be like to think that Paul is in prison? This is it for him. Your pastor, your leader, it's all over for him. Said and done, he's in jail. And he writes this letter and says, I'm going to come to you, man. And they're thinking, you're in jail. And Nero's just around the corner. You're going to die. Could you imagine what it was like when the Apostle Paul to be walking in Philippi one day? What kind of joy and what kind of faith that they would have, the excitement they would have that their pastor is not dead. Here's the Apostle Paul, just like he said. He was confident that God would deliver them for their furtherance and also their joy. Could you imagine the excitement to say, hey, looky here. Paul is here. He made it through that. And what that does for a believer when somebody else gets delivered, it gives them hope, it gives them security, and it gives them more confidence in what God can do for them. To see the Apostle Paul get delivered from his situation and him having confidence and faith the whole time, say, I'm coming out of here, boys. Don't count me out yet. I might be down, but I ain't out. I'm coming out of here. Come on, And then all of a sudden he comes walking in town and said, I told you so. Yeah. It increases their joy, of course, like the scripture says, their hope and their confidence, their security. And they're thinking, hey, if God could do that for him to bring him out of prison and bring him back here so we could see him again, look at what God could do in my present situation. And it builds confidence in them. And great joy. I could just see him walking in town. What might happen? I know for me, my pastor was still living. Just to see Brother Dennis, man, it brought joy to my heart. To know that he was around. I could only imagine that the Apostle Paul comes walking in. He said, God, I'm confident that God's going to take care of me because God wants to take care of you. God wants to further you. God wants to grow. And I'm confident tonight to tell you that if you're in some situation, you have somebody around you that's difficult to deal with, God wants to further you and God wants to bring joy. One of the great, if you have somebody, your boss or co-worker or whatever that's difficult, pray for them. Pray God will save them. You see somebody that's cold and different and people would count them out and say they'll never get saved. I promise you they said that about me. That boy will never make nothing. Voted most likely to not succeed. That boy will never be nothing. John Gadd will never be nothing. Larry Klein, you can forget him. He'll never be nothing. Robert Jackson, Bobby Everett, Brenda Everett, never be nothing. And then look here on Wednesday night. In the house of God, worshiping God. God's cleaned our life up, changed us, gave us new direction. We're no longer hard to deal with on the job. We're no longer, now we have our difficult days like everybody. We're not the same as what we used to do. We're not going the same places. And all of a sudden we've been changed. It gives great joy in my heart to see people doing that. And that's the way it was for Paul. He said, I'm coming. I'm going to see you one of these days. He had great confidence. And he knew that God was going to further them or progress them. And one day they would have great joy. Look at verse number 26. He says that your rejoicing may be more abundant in Christ Jesus. This is why God's going to do it. This is why God's going to bring me out of this jail. This is why I'm going to see you one of these days. Be more abundant in Jesus Christ for me by coming to you again. Then in verse number 27, let me say that. Look at Paul's behavior deferred or given to somebody else. Look at Paul's. Now, Paul's spoken about his behavior inside the jail. And we know his story. We know the scripture. Paul said, I know, and whatsoever state that I am, therewith to be content. Wherever I'm at, I'm a winner either way. And Paul said, my life is right. My living is right. Now, Paul defers that to them in verse number 27. It says, only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ. Now that word only means singularly, solo. And when Paul said in chapter 1, verse number 6, he said, being confident of this very thing, he's saying the same thing in verse number 27, being confident only in this very thing, that let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ. I looked up that phrase, as it becometh the gospel of Christ. And it actually means to behave as a citizen of Christ. To behave as a citizen of Christ. Every town has their way that they live. Every country has their way that they live. In the South, we are different from the North. And up north, they are different from us. Can I get some help? Amen. And Scottish people are different. They have the highlands and the lowlands, and they're totally different. The Italians are totally different from the Germans. The Germans are totally different. They have a way of doing things. They're totally different. But we live as Americans. We live as Southerners. We say yuns and y'all and reckon and ain't. We say all those words, at least I do. We say those words, and we live as Southerners. What he's trying to say is, you live as Christ, or you live as a Christian, and he defers the behavior. He's saying, I'm doing this in my situation where I'm at in prison, in jail. Now he defers that to them and gives it to them and said, now you live your life. Now you're outside. You're outside. You live your life. Let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ. So Paul defers and says, okay, Philippi, now I've taught you how to live. I even showed you how to live. Now live it out in your life, in everyday life. It's been said that you can take the boy out of the country, but you can't never take the country out of the boy. It's the same thing with a believer. You can take a believer out of church, but you can't take the belief out of the believer. And Paul is saying, live accordingly. I've showed you. I've taught you how to live. Live like that. Then verse number 28, look at Paul's benefit described. What's the benefit? What's all this about? Let's finish verse 27 and finish out the verse. And see you, or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs. He said, if I don't even make it to you, I'm going to hear about your affairs if I don't get to Philippi. That ye stand fast in one spirit and one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. In verse number 28, look at Paul's benefit described. And in nothing terrified by your adversary. Don't get scared. Don't get tore up. Don't get beside yourself, which is to them, your adversary, an evident token of perdition, but to you of salvation and that of God. What he's saying is when your salvation, when you come through this and God saves you and keeps you through what you're going through, no matter who that difficult person is or that difficult circumstance, when God brings you through and you're still living it out like verse number 27 says, that's going to account for your salvation and a merit against the adversary, because one of these days he has nothing but destruction and misery ahead of him. Every time we live the gospel out in verse number 27, every time we live it like we should live it, that's only showing him more truth than what God has said by saving us and changing our life and making us like his son, conformed into his image. Every time we do that, that just reminds the adversary that he has a dying day when he's going to spend eternity in hell and the lake of fire. Because of our life, it proves to him that God's word is true. Does that make sense? When I live it before the adversary, when I live before the adversary a Christian life, it only proves God's word true that he says. 2 Corinthians 5:17, if any man be a Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. When I live that out, that proves that scripture is true. Can somebody help me a little bit? My life reflects that. That's just another token for God that I'm truly saved and what God says is real. That makes sense? So in turn, when I don't, it does the direct opposite, right? So when we live out verse number 27, let our conversation be as it becomes the gospel of Christ. The only thing on our mind is the gospel and getting it, progressing it. It's an evident token of salvation and that of God, not a work that we do. It's what God is doing on the inside. That's why I say all the time that a lot of people are going to miss heaven because they're trying to work out their salvation. They're trying to do these things. The work of true Christianity and salvation comes from a work wrought of God. It's not us. We talked about that. He's the author and finisher, the performer in the middle of it. We don't do this. If you're doing it, you need to get to a place where you give it to Christ, your life, your heart, and everything, and let him live it out. If it's hard all the time and you just say, I can't do this, you can't. Give it to God and say, God, it's yours. I need your salvation, not my own. And let him work that out in you. It's not of what we've done. It's exactly what he has done. And it's an evident token when we do what is right. And Paul is saying your salvation will show their end or the adversary's end in your salvation. What you've done with Christ will show the adversary their end. Your steadfastness, your as we talked about on Sunday morning, your commitment to Christ, will only prove their end is true. If God is able to keep me and God is able to keep you, and as Paul's life, when he kept him through prison, Paul said, whatever happens, happens. It is what it is. I'm a winner either way. God promised to take care of me. Paul was proving God's scriptures true and that God was true. So we see the benefit, Paul's benefit described. This is the good of it. Then in verse number 29, he says, for unto you it is given in the behalf of Christ, not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake. One of the three things that every believer must do is mentioned in verse number 29. We'll back up to 27 for the other two. But there are three things that a believer must do, and all of us need the help of each other to do it. Three things that he mentions. Look in verse number 27. We'll be finishing up in just a couple hours at least. Three things that a believer must do in 27b. Look, it says that ye stand fast in one spirit. The first thing that a believer must do, that we are dependent upon every other believer, is that we stand fast. And that word stand fast means to preserve, to hold a place, to stand fast, to hold a place, to preserve. And that's the duty of believers. That's why we have to be faithful. We have to be, as we said Sunday morning, we got to be committed, because we are preserving a spot in this generation to pass on to the next generation. That's what the Word of God means when it says we stand fast. And you cannot stand fast. Moses and Aaron and Hur was a beautiful picture of how he couldn't stand fast himself, but Aaron and Hur come and supported his arms, and they were able together to stand fast for the Lord. And as long as those arms were up, they were winning. As long as those arms were down, they were losing. The same is true with believers in today's time. You cannot stand by yourself. You cannot stand by yourself. Somebody's independence that says, oh yeah, I can. And Paul said in another place, he said, take heed. If you he that thinks he's able to stand, take heed, lest he falls. People that are so high and mighty say, I don't need church, or I don't need that believer, I'll just do my own thing. It won't be long till they'll fall. We have to stand fast, and it takes everybody. And then he says in 27c, stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, look what he says, striving together for the faith of the gospel. The word striving together means to wrestle in a company, what we would call a tag team. I mean, if you're really bored, you might still watch that stuff, but the WWF or something. Hogan used to, you know, he'd be in there fighting, and they'd do the tag team partners, and they'd have somebody else come running down the aisle. I could only imagine what it's like today, and not promote it at all. But somebody else would come running down. He'd get in trouble, and he'd, you know, jump over the ring or over the wires. He'd stick his hand out, and he'd tag, and then he'd start that fake dropping and all that stuff. Y'all didn't. Somebody just found out right now it's fake, right? It's a tag team. It was a partnership, and that's what he means by striving together, wrestling together, fighting together in a company, in a host. Then in verse number 29, he says, the third one, he said, stand fast, he said, strive together, and he also said, suffer for him. Another thing that we cannot do alone. Not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake. Can any man live godly in Christ Jesus? He shall, not maybe, not might. He will suffer persecution. And when persecution comes, we need each other. We need each other. So you suffer together. You feel that word suffer for him means to feel the pain. You see people working out, they feel the burn. You feel the burn of other people. Paul's behalf distributed, given out. This is the part of suffering with Christ, standing with Christ, and striving with Christ. We need each other. And then verse number 30, we'll be through. Miss Geneva, come and get a song of invitation. He said, having the same conflict which you saw in me, now here to be in me. And when he says having the same conflict, he's saying you as believers where you're at, having the same conflict. Now, they wasn't in prison. They wasn't in jail just like the Apostle Paul. But no matter where you're at as a believer, you're going to have a battle. Yours is going to be different from mine, but you're going to be battling every day of your life. You think getting into Christian faith, you're going to get, life's going to be easier. You're going to have a battle from the day you get saved to the day you pass away or the rapture happens. We're going to have that. We need each other. So we see Paul's backlash declared in verse number 30. This is what happens. He said, the things that happened to me, it's happening to you too. I'm having to stand. I'm having to profess the gospel, stand fast here. I'm striving together. I'm suffering for Christ. He said, the same thing's going to be working in you, but for the Apostle Paul to be where he's at and where they're at, it should have been easy for them to look and say, look at what Paul's doing and look at where he's at. And he is able to stand fast. He is able to strive. He's able to suffer for Christ. If he can do it there, I can do it right here. He said, we can do this. And Paul's saying, the same thing's happening to me. It's going to happen to you, or it's probably happening right now. I read a little thing this evening that talked about sports. And it said in sports, it's very hard to win when you're on the road. Two same teams playing against each other. But it's very difficult when you go on the road and you go to another stand or another place of court or whatever to play basketball. Very difficult to win when you go somewhere else. Because the people that are there, you go to their home court, they have home court advantage. And they said in football, they said when they look at the stats before the game, they automatically win. They automatically give 7 points to the home team. So if it was even, if it was going to be 14-14, they'd go ahead and add another 7 to the home team because they have people that rally just because of the support that they have, having home field advantage or home court advantage, just because of people exhorting them and lifting them up and cheering for them, because most of the time you have more at home cheering than you do at an away game. And they said that you automatically add 7 points because they had home field or home court advantage. Just because there was somebody there cheering them on. Can somebody help me preach a little bit? What it would do for us and what it can do for us to have our home court advantage here at the church to support and rally around. Just knowing somebody's with you. Just know somebody's, hey, I got you back, brother. I got you back, sister. I'm here with you. I'm striving with you. Giving a text, sending a card, encouraging somebody, praying with them at the altar. Those things exhort. That helps them through their process and their pain. Striving together. The church, we have the home field advantage. When we encourage people, we stand with somebody, we strive with them, we suffer with them, it gives us home court advantage. And people will make it through, and that's what Paul was trying to get across to the Philippian church. You're going to get through this because look where I'm at. If it had been the other way around, think about it very quickly and I'm through. If it had been the other way around, if the Philippian church had been writing Paul and said, hey, Paul, man, don't worry about that. It's no big deal. You're a winner either way, Paul. You're going to make it through this. Paul would say, what? You're not the one in prison. You're sleeping with your wife at night. You're hugging your daughter and son at night and going to bed. What you talking about? But it was the other way around. Paul was saying to them, not in all certain terms. He didn't say it like I would say it. He didn't say, hey, you got it made out there. He's just saying simply, look at where I'm at. Look at what God has done. And he said, I'm confident in this very thing. God's going to deliver me. And God's going to do the same for you. Let's stand. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Father, we love you. Lord, thank you, God, for your word. Every time I preach, Lord, I say, I wish I had more words. I wish I could describe it more. God, I've done the best with what I have and what you've given me. And I pray Lord, that you'd use to encourage somebody's life. Somebody is standing right now, I stand with them. I pray for them. I encourage them, God. If they're striving, I want to strive together. If they're suffering for you, Lord, I want to suffer with them. I want them to know that I'm here. And Lord, I can look and see people in this church in my mind's eye when I've strived and suffered and stood. They were right there beside me, fighting with me. Just knowing somebody's there makes a difference in the fight. As a spouse lays in the bed at night, sometimes all alone, when that other spouse comes in and lays in the bed, just knowing that they're there, it gives comfort. The same is so with the church. Just knowing that somebody's there with you. May we have confidence like Paul. May we be encouraged like the Philippian church to know that, Lord, if you've done it for that church, if you've done it for Paul in that time, you'll do it for us. Through all this, the common core tonight, Lord, is unity among believers. And every book we dive into, common theme through that book is believers need each other and need to be unified. Lord, may we lift each other up and help each other. Bless this invitation time and this song. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. If you've got a need tonight, why don't you come?